थैंक यू।
4:30 बज गए. शैल वी स्टार्ट रितिका जी, शैल वी स्टार्ट, शैल वी और शैल वी वेट फॉर 4-5 मिनट्स?
सर अभी पार्टिसिपेंट्स ज्वाइन कर रहे हैं. और
अच्छा जी, अच्छा अश्विनी जी, अच्छा ठीक है, तो वी कैन वेट फॉर अ फ्यू मिनट्स. एंड आई वाज गोइंग टू आस्क यू सुनंदा जी दैट यू आर सपोज टू बी इन अनदर मीटिंग आल्सो, राइट?
राइट नाउ
No, no, obviously not right now. But I mean, oh. You're so busy on this topic. I think you were speaking.
Yes, I have two meetings today, and then I have another one tomorrow, and then one on 8th and one on 9th.
That's what I mean. So we are all the more grateful and honored.
No, when you invited me, I was very keen on speaking at this platform because more than any other platform, and I'm one can use some nuance here, and one can expect discussion at a different level. So I was really looking forward to this, so I'm very, very happy to be here.
Thank you. I hope we don't disappoint you, but no, you're absolutely right that that this is obviously not the usual kind of
what you might call a different platform, a more academic platform, and that's why I was really looking forward to speak to people of such eminence.
Thank you so much. Thank you. What are your other engagements on this topic? Where else are you speaking?
Tonight, Indic Academy in Washington, D.C. is holding a conference with Mr. Subhash Clark and myself. And that is going to be a conversation about Kashmir through millennia, not entirely 370. We're trying to find out where history begins in Kashmir, because that is such a hotly contested topic. So we're taking a different route there. And then tomorrow, I think it's a Washington, D.C. based organization. And that's pure geopolitical. They want to know how 370 will affect Indo-US and Indo-Sino-India relationship. And so, same topic, but different facets, different, ways to approach it. So I'm looking forward to all of them. This has been interesting.
Right. That's wonderful. Ritika ji, shall we start now? Aapki awaaz nahi aa rahi, sunai nahi de raha.
Sir, we can start now. We have a good number of participants.
Okay. Lovely. Wonderful. Thank you. So, as usual, everybody, please mute your mics so that there's no echo. I shall also, after the preliminary remarks, mute mine. And another little housekeeping announcement, especially to Sunanda ji. You would have noticed that there are three links, part one, part two, part three, because, we get logged out after about 50 minutes because our corporate account hasn't been activated. So my apologies in advance. So we will all eagerly rejoin you after the 50 minutes are done for the next 50 minutes for the Q&A, or you'll even get some time to wind up. It's not that by the end of the first 50 minutes, you get cut off. Aisa kuch nahi hai. You're most welcome to continue in the second part as well, and then wind up. And then we'll have a Q&A. Usually, we more or less finish in the 2 50-minute slots, so about 1.5 hours, 1 hour 40 minutes. Is our usual time slot. So if everybody is all right and on board, and if Sadaji is okay with this, we will start. Sab ke liye ye agar suvidha janak ho to hum shuru karein. I can't see anybody. I can only see Hitendra ji for some reason. But I think I've got a thumbs up from him. So I take it that it is from all our fellows. So main maan ke chalta hoon ki we can start. So, dear fellows, It's a real treat and honor for me to present to you Ms. Sunanda Vashisht this afternoon. For her, it's very early morning. It's 6 o'clock. So I'm deeply honored and grateful that she joined us, took so much personal trouble to join us on this important topic. And now, you know, Sunandaji, normally our activities are not so news-driven, I must clarify. Like tomorrow is the anniversary of the, I wouldn't call it abrogation, but alteration of Article 370 of the Constitution. And today there was a foundation laying ceremony at Ayodhya. Very, very important, one might say defining moments for the Republic. And as I said, we are not normally news-driven, but we still want to reflect deeply as our founder, President Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, intended us to reflect deeply on the human condition, on issues of national integration, and of matters that concern all of us in India and abroad. And it is from that perspective that we invited you today to give your views on this topic, which is Kashmir after Article 370, dismantling the status quo. I just wanted to say one or two words by way of this topic, and then I'll introduce you briefly. You know, our own interest in this matter has been ongoing because we hosted an important conference here at IIAS on the political economy of terrorism in Kashmir. And this was quite some time before parliamentary debates on Article 370 commenced. And at that time, in our introductory, keynote speech, General Katoch, he from the platform of IIAS, he made a very bold declaration. He said, "Ye Article 370 ko hata do, aadhi samasya khatam ho jayegi." You know, we have his recording as well. And he actually analyzed it. He said that 35A was not even known. It was almost like a stealthy addition to 370. I think that there were some very powerful messages that went up from this platform. And then in our distinguished webinar series in which we were trying to come to grips with a post-COVID world, our first speaker was General Syed Atta Hasnain, who had served in Kashmir. And this morning, I can tell you, he wrote an important op-ed on Jammu and Kashmir in Times of India. I'll just read a few lines from there. "For the last 30 years, we've been subjected to a subconventional proxy war by Pakistan, making use of the schisms it created within society in J&K. Although India had effectively used the kinetic route to curb Pakistan's capability to change things, it never could sufficiently address the issue politically for lasting effect. The center dithered and lacked the confidence to comprehensively address the prickly issues sustaining the conflict. Imagining a non-existent Pakistani capability masterfully packaged to create a defensive psyche within India. Articles 370 and 35A helped create a self-image for J&K of it being different, a psyche instilling a belief of never being part of the Indian mainstream. That psyche, in turn, fostered a delusive belief about Azadi, independence, which is unachievable given JNK's demographic makeup and geostrategic location, an unreal belief that, however permeated every quarter, it was exploited by the deep state in Pakistan to create a perpetual state of proxy war. Existing within the establishment and the political community was a long embedded belief that even touching the constitutional exclusivity of J&K would mean unbearable consequences. It needed a transformational decision to break this perpetuating cycle," unquote. So the point I'm trying to make is that this morning, I looked at the papers, Sunandaji, both the Hindi and the English, and you can see the op-ed debates, two sides. Like, I'll just give you an example. In, I think it was Hindustan Times, Radha Kumar wrote on one side of the debate saying that, look, this is the end of, Kashmir and the India that we know and so forth. And on the other side, you had an equally well-articulated position on this by none other than Ram Madhavji, who's played an active role. So what I'm trying to say is that for us at IIAS, such matters are very important because we want to reflect deeply on them, going into the roots and the shoots, not just to treat them as political, ideological, scoring points. We want to really reflect on these things deeply. And I can't think of anybody better than you for a couple of reasons, which I can spell out in a moment, than you to speak on this, Sunandaji. First of all, friends, I must tell you that Sunandaji belongs to a new generation of writers, scholars, commentators, and I would say cultural and intellectual entrepreneurs. Now, the latter, the last part of the description is very important, because we're living in a different age now, where you can create your own platform, where you are a producer as well as disseminator of knowledge. It's not that you have to write only for Hindustan Times, So there's a new way in which, like self-documentaries, everybody with a camera or a cell phone and an internet connection can make an impact out there. She has millions of followers on social media, and she's the founder of myindmakers.com, a very active website. You can check it out, which gives you good content, a reasoned and well-substantiated content. It's Houston-based. Her partners there are Adit Kapadia and Pramod Kumar Bhurawali. Now, I happened to get in touch with this wonderful group in Houston when I was invited there to give a talk, which she chaired, actually, on the future of higher education in India. And then she did a wonderful tete-a-tete, a one-on-one with me at her home with Aditji on a variety of topics, that concern JNU and nationalism and so on and so forth. And subsequently, we got to know each other a little bit. But the important thing, in addition to this aspect of her, contribution, I want to mention just two other things which are very important. One is that she's actually, somebody who's experienced the whatever you call it, the displacement, the genocide of Kashmiri Pandits in 1990 and ongoing thereof. She may tell us something about it. I mean, she was right there in Baramulla. Her father was a professor there. And, she grew up with that trauma of displacement. And then the family came to Delhi. She was educated at St. Stephen's College, my own alma mater, before and for BA and MA in my own discipline, literature. And then afterwards, she went abroad and they are settled there. Wonderful family, Mr. Vashisht, her husband and two lovely children. So in other words, there's an experiential component to this. And, I have guided students from both sides. I had a student whom I've guided who actually told me, I don't want to take names, that he was recruited and he was taught to use an AK-47. And he said, how I saved myself from that. And he was also a Bhat, though converted, Anyhow. So I have to guide the students. We've seen both sides of the picture. So she has a unique perspective, an experiential perspective. And the last thing I'll say is that you must check out her testimony, at the U.S. Congress's Human Rights Commission, which was chaired by Tom Lantos, U.S. Congressman Tom Lantos, in 2015. It's on YouTube. You must see how she spoke up for a displaced and almost disenfranchised minority. Displaced, I say, because not only out of Kashmir, it's a double loss that so many of them have lost India as well, And I remember one professor, a dear friend of mine, who was teaching at University of Kashmir in Srinagar, and he came and he said, "Humne jo slogan sune, bhai saab, wo aise the, हस्के लेंगे हिंदुस्तान लेके लेंगे पाकिस्तान तो उसी तरह तो अब सारा हिंदुस्तान हमारा है और कश्मीर भी हमारा है सो ही वाज ट्राइंग टू टेल मी व्हाट द पंडित्स वर एक्चुअली फेसिंग एंड आई हैड अ वंडरफुल इनसाइट व्हेन आई स्पोक विद हिम व्हिच इज दैट हाउ डू यू कसौटी क्या होगी हाउ डू यू मापदंड क्या है हाउ डू यू जज अ माइनॉरिटी कम्युनिटी व्हिच क्लेम्स टू बी oppressed by the state. You judge them by how they treat their own minorities. The minority within the minority is as good a yardstick to judge how just the claims of the minority complaining against state repression are. So, you know, it was a wonderful insight for me to engage with this displaced professor. And the last thing I want to say is that there's a global dimension now, as I just mentioned, to the struggle of the Kashmiri Pandits, almost like the Jewish diaspora. You know, the Kashmiri diaspora now of the Pandits, not just of the other Kashmiris, they're a very small community, you know. I'm not sure what the numbers are, Sunandaji, but maybe 4 or 5 lakhs, not more than that, perhaps. It's a very small community, and a lot of them are not even in India. But this global fight, you know, to provide an alternative point of view is also very interesting to me, because I think that it's not just a matter of a struggle within India, nor is it just a subcontinental issue, you know. It's really a global issue. So with these words, Sunandaji, welcome once again, all yours. Thank you for joining us today. Thank you.
Thank you thank so you. Much, Patanji. I have been with you on so many platforms, and I have always said that it's a tall order talking after you. I wish I never had to do it. You always speak so well. And but anyhow, good afternoon, everyone. I am delighted to be here today. I would have loved to be in IIAS in person, and I have indeed wanted to visit you all in IIAS for a long time. But I suppose during global pandemic, this is the second best thing we could do. I must thank Professor Makarand Paranjpe for giving me this opportunity to speak here. And I was really looking forward to it, because I think, to my mind, IIAS stands for excellence and scholarship of highest degree. In the world of limited attention spans and 280 characters, I'm happy to be given this platform where one can speak without noise, nuance can be appreciated, and ideas can be fearlessly discussed, which is very important for me. The topic for today's talk is dismantling the status quo, Kashmir after abrogation of Article 370. Exactly a year ago today, on August 5th, 2019, Article 370 of Indian Constitution and Article 35A, which did not even exist in Indian Constitution, but was around our neck, you know, all the which hung around our neck like an albatross, but both were abrogated exactly a year ago today. One of my favorite politicians is Ronald Reagan. He was a very sensible and a very witty man. And his wisdom, you will remember, was very folksy, very earthy. One of his famous quotes is, "Status quo, you know, is Latin for the mess we are in." I couldn't describe Article 370 and its impact on Kashmir and India more quickly. Article 370 truly stood for the mess we are in. Article 370 meant different things to different people. To constitutional experts, it was a riddle. To politicians in Valley, it meant a whip to keep their flock together. To minorities like me, it was a tool of oppression, and I'll come back to it later during my speech. To Dogras, to Ladakhis, to Safai Karamcharis, to West Pakistan refugees, it meant something entirely different. However, there was consensus on only one point. The consensus was that this article was temporary, because that's what the Constitution described this as. That a temporary provision of Constitution was allowed to continue for 7 decades makes one question what the meaning of temporary really is. Temporary means it has to end at some point, a reasonable time. And 70 years is a good enough time for temporary to either become permanent or be done away with for good. So The way I'm going to sort of talk today is, arrange my talk is, I'll briefly explain what Article 370 was so that we are on the same page, and then I can get into the abrogation part of it. Article 370 of Indian Constitution allowed Jammu and Kashmir to have a unique special status within the Indian Union. What that meant was the government of India had powers to make laws for all states on the items included in the union list and the concurrent list, except J&K, where besides defense, foreign affairs and communication, it could make or amend laws only with the approval of the state government. Over a period of time, it is true that some changes were made to Article 370 to include jurisdiction of Supreme Court, Election Commission, and Comptroller and Auditor General CNAG. Even these were not there in the initial draft. So these amendments were made, but there were still many areas under the exclusive control of state government. Article 370 allowed the state of Jammu and Kashmir to have a separate constitution and a separate flag, which made it the only state in the constitution in the Indian, which made it the only state in the Indian Union to have that privilege. The unfortunate reality of separate constitution, besides the obvious feeding of alienation, is that it allowed for certain laws which were outdated, unfair, and stood in direct conflict with the progressive laws of Constitution of India. The Constitution of India, as you all know, recognizes single citizenship for all its citizens. So while residents of Jammu and Kashmir are automatically citizens of India, residents of rest of the India could not become citizens of J&K before this article was abrogated. Residents of J&K could own property in any part of the India, and rightly so. But residents of other states could not do so in J&K. The property rights in J&K were so outdated and unfair that till 2002, women who married non-state subjects, like myself, lost inheritance rights in Kashmir. This was not true for the men marrying non-residents of the state. This blatant unfairness was set right to some extent by J&K High Court judgment in 2002, which allowed women marrying outside states to inherit and buy or sell property. However, children of women married to non-state subjects didn't have the same rights. My children did not. If I inherited the property in Jammu and Kashmir, my parents' property, my children did not have the rights over that property. They cannot inherit, nor can they buy or sell property. Because to buy and sell property, a state subject certificate was required. And in J&K, till August 5, 2019, state subject certificate was given on the basis of permanent residence status, PRC, and the status was the permanent residence status of father or husband only. Imagine that. And this was such an extremely unfair law that officially promoted gender inequality. While PDP and National Conference, traditional political rivals in the state, as you know, can hardly agree on anything, they joined hands to oppose this law, which was so blatantly anti-women. It has been 17 years till August 5, 2019. It had been almost 17 years since the J&K High Court judgment was passed. But look at the chicanery of state government. Government websites had never updated this to reflect the new law. It seemed intentional that for the last 17 years, no orders were given to update or change the website in accordance with the J&K High Court judgment. Not only was this grievous contempt of law, it also showed how National Conference and PDP had both ensured that ordinary folks remain in dark about the new law and got lost in the bureaucratic maze because it suited them. And this is just one aspect of this illiberal and regressive Article 370. I have seen over the years that politicians had created a fear psychosis out of this piece of legislation, which was originally meant to be temporary and provisional. It had often been communicated to people, sometimes in my presence, that without this article, their identity will be eroded and some terrible misfortune will befall Kashmir. In election rallies, I have seen local politicians instigate people in the name of Article 370. Kayamat or apocalypse was threatened if 370 was even debated. Forget about anything else. Just to give you a small anecdote, as a child growing up in Kashmir, and I grew up in Srinagar and not Baramulla, just correcting that little bit of information that Professor Makarand Pranjpe said. I grew up in Srinagar, Kashmir, and when I was barely learning to talk, I had heard about 370. It was this all-pervading, omnipresent, and completely controlled your life. First of all, it gave you a sense of hyphenated citizenship, which for minorities could only mean trouble. And second, Article 370 had been unnecessarily made into a super emotional issue with Kashmiris. It had been conveyed to them that this is their only weapon against India. It is linked with the bogus term Kashmiriyat, which meant nothing. On January 19, 1990, Kashmiriyat, whatever it existed, I lived in Kashmir, but I have not known what Kashmiriyat is. All my writing and whatever I have said since will bear testimony to that fact. But whatever little remains or whatever little existed of Kashmiriyat was consigned to the trash can of history on January 19, 1990, when my community was thrown out. Forcibly, I must add. So to connect this with Kashmiriyat meant really nothing. And demographic changes that are often talked about had already happened. On the minute we left, the minute we were thrown out of our homes, demographic change had already happened. The Indian Constitution, as we all know, is a splendid document which provides equal rights to all its citizens without discriminating on the basis of caste, color, creed, or religion. As citizens of India, people of Jammu and Kashmir need nothing more than the protection by the Constitution of India. The fact is, there was nothing sacrosanct about this article. The sad reality, which is often glossed over, is that it's because of this contentious piece of legislation, people of the state had been kept impoverished, development remained a distant dream, integration and assimilation with mainstream India became impossible, minorities were thrown out, Dogras of Jammu felt alienated, Ladakhis felt they had no voice. It was all around, as Ronald Reagan said, a mess. To tell you how local politicians spoke about Article 370, I once remember watching Farooq Abdullah, the former chief minister from National Conference Party, and former chief minister of erstwhile J&K state, on television news. And he said, Article 370 is very important for the people of Kashmir. And when pressed why, he said, don't ask me why. This pretty much sums up the political opinion about Article 370 in Kashmir. Before this was abrogated, you had politicians, Kashmiri politicians, this valley-based politicians, because no other politician was allowed to even come up. So the entire Kashmir policy and everything was looked at from the valley prism. So the politicians would say that, you know, long after India is destroyed, or long after, Narendra Modi government is over, 370 will remain, or there will be no one here to uphold the Tiranga or tricolor if 370 is abrogated, forgetting that the state of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh is not just the four troubled districts of the valley. A lot of people forget this, and I speak at forums across the world. Most people are unaware about the geography on Jammu and Kashmir. And I always say, and people think I say this in jest, but I don't. I say that half the problem of Jammu and Kashmir would be solved if people looked at the map of Jammu and Kashmir. you know, and understood that the trouble is just a very small portion of the state, and the state is huge. There's Jammu, there is Ladakh, and there's a huge state. Article 370 was not a tunnel that connected India to J&K. It was actually an impediment which kept J&K separately alienated. We were also told that if Article 370 is abrogated, J&K's accession to India becomes questionable. This is important, and I want to spend just a minute talking about it, because you must have also heard about, you know, people waxing eloquent that if Article 370 goes, then there's nothing that connects Kashmir, J&K to India. This is a myth that needed to be demolished, and I'm glad it was demolished. The Maharaja Hari Singh, the king of erstwhile princely state of Jammu and Kashmir, signed the papers of accession on October 26, 1947. It was the same exact document that every princely state acceding to India signed. Same document that was signed by Bhopal, same document that was signed by Hyderabad, same document that was signed by Junagadh, same document that was signed by Bikaner, same document that was signed by everyone. This part you may know. The other part is something that people will not often tell you. Sheikh Abdullah, who represented the voice of people at that time in the valley, prevailed upon Prime Minister Nehru that State Assembly will take the final decision on accession. Fair enough. For the intervening time, Article 370 was conceived as a temporary provision. The State Assembly ratified the decision later, and if I'm not mistaken, 1956. And after that moment, Article 370 became redundant. Even Sheikh Abdullah had said that once this decision is ratified, then there is no need for any Article 370. However, it never went. It just kept there. It just stayed. It should have been scrapped at the same time. I must tell you that after Nehru dismissed Sheikh Abdullah government and put him in jail, and Sheikh Abdullah stayed in jail off and on from 1953 to 1975, much after Prime Minister Nehru had passed on during Prime Minister Shastri's reign, he stayed in jail. Then Indira Ji kept him in jail for a long time. So there was continuous, all this time from 1953 to 1975, there was continuous Congress government in J&K. In the center also, we had Congress government continuously with a small interlude of Janata government in between. Yet, Congress government did nothing to repeal this article. And with the result, it kept becoming a myth bigger and bigger than ever. The question now is, why did Congress governments or subsequent governments not do anything about this? And the only answer to this is it points to the proverbial elephant in the room that everyone knew existed, but no one talked about it openly. This elephant in the room was the silent acceptance that J&K must be given special status because it's the only Muslim majority state in India. There is no other reason. The only reason that J&K at that time people thought that must be given special status was because of its Muslim majority, because of its demographics. Now think about this. What could be more detrimental to the idea of India? What could deliver a bigger blow to the secular fabric of our nation? Nothing more could expose our hypocrisy in denying two-nation theory of Jinnah and then being comfortable with Article 370. How can you reject two-nation theory and say that we do not believe in this two-nation theory where Hindus and Muslims cannot coexist, and yet accept that an only Muslim-dominated state in India will have some special status more than the other citizens of India? Every citizen of India enjoys equal rights. Every citizen of India has equal right to her resources. And every citizen of India enjoys freedom and liberty. two constitutions, two flags, and two emblems just could not exist in one nation. It's unthinkable that this was continued. This scam, I call it a scam, was continued for 70 years. On August 5th, 2019, however, Narendra Modi government finally did the unthinkable. I think after BJP's aborted alliance with PDP, and I went public about it, and I wrote several op-eds, and I publicly spoke against the alliance with PDP because I knew what was going to happen. And some of us know where PDP has come from and what it stands for. Yet the alliance went through, but soon it had to be aborted. And I think at this point, the government of India realized that maintaining the status quo and playing musical chair with two valley-based political parties and allowing this oligarchy to go on was no longer tenable. It was time to remove the smokescreen and time for New Delhi to speak to Jammu and Kashmir in one voice. It was time to tell Kashmiris, Dogras, Ladakhis that they're equal citizens who enjoy all rights just as every other citizen of India. It was time for the Constitution of India to be applicable in its entirety in every nook and corner of both Union territories. Any of you who have interest in studying Jammu and Kashmir would have always noticed that politicians of JNK often speak in two tongues. You know, they have two set of speeches. They give one speech in Srinagar and they give another one in Delhi. They say one thing in its fourth, they speak in fourth tongue. They speak one thing in inside the state, the erstwhile JNK State's assembly, and they would say another thing in the streets of Delhi. However, we have to understand that New Delhi also did not speak in one voice to Kashmir. Even we were happy allowing the status quo to happen. Even we were allowing it, you know, by giving monetary doles, by allowing, you know, just putting everything under the carpet. We were not telling people of Jammu and Kashmir what their status was. For 70 years, they lived in this hyphenated citizenship mode where they did not know if they fully belonged to Kashmir, if they fully belonged to India, and what was going on. We allowed this confusion. So it was both ways. I'm finally glad that, you know, it took this one, it happened by stealth. I mean, most people did not even know it was happening. I for sure went to all TV channels that morning or a night before because things were getting bad in Kashmir. And everyone knew something was happening, but I went and proclaimed on all TV channels and all my social media handles that, you know, whatever happens, 370 will not be abrogated, because I did not think in my lifetime anybody would have guts to do that. So I was so happy to be proven wrong. But anyhow, coming to this, most people think, and maybe rightly so, that, you know, abrogation of Article 370 was an ideological commitment for BJP, and it was in their manifesto. And I'm sure, and this is true, there is nothing wrong about it. I mean, there is, it's not a false statement, it's a true statement. But however, what I have, even I said that in the beginning a year ago, but the series of systemic reforms that I have witnessed in the two union territories in last 1 year make it amply clear that abrogation was not merely a political statement or an ideological commitment. It was both of them, but the reforms now point out to that it was more than that. The first major reform has been the passing of the domicile law, which increases the categories of those who can claim a domicile status and also recognizes all stakeholders who had been disenfranchised earlier and kept out of the political mainstream. The new law paves way for every citizen of India, and this is important. The new law paves way for every citizen of India to become domicile of JNK after 15 years of residence. Safai karmcharis, sanitation workers, who had been brought from Punjab, Gurkhas, and West Pakistan refugees who had come at the time of accession. After years of being denied equal rights, because the state government had the right to determine who gets a PRC, permanent resident certificate, and who doesn't, and they kept all of them out, they finally have been covered under the new domicile law. They are now eligible for government jobs, and any affirmative action guaranteed by the Indian Constitution in any government-run educational institutions. Dalits in J&K were kept out of benefit that the Indian Constitution guarantees to them elsewhere in the country. And I, as I had said before, children of women who married outside J&K were deprived of inheritance rights. The new domicile law corrects this historical wrong and this gender inequality. Now, children of women married to non-domiciles can acquire a domicile certificate immediately. I mean, just on the basis, my children can now get a domicile certificate because I am a domicile and inherit what is rightfully theirs. The abrogation of Article 370, as I said in the US Congress last year, is not a suspension, but a restoration of human rights. It is quite ironic that human rights activists rarely raise their voices for those who are really oppressed and discriminated by now defunct Constitution of J&K. I'm used to the human rights activists not speaking about Hindus of Kashmir because we are the wrong demographics, we're the wrong people to be talking about it. But what about Dalits? What about the Safai Karamcharis? What about the Valmiki community? What about the Gurkhas? What about the, where were the feminists? When you know, who always talk about gender rights, none of them were seen talking about Article 370 or 35. India, as a union of states, as you know, recognizes state domicile for subjects if the state chooses to do so for her own subjects. This is primarily a way to prioritize those who have been living in the state for a few years over those who have never lived in the state. It happens in most states. And the prioritization is typically done in state government jobs where domiciles are given priority. The new domicile law paves way for every citizen of India to become domicile now after 15 years of residence. Some people have questioned the time limit of 15 years and have said that this is bringing in 370 via backdoor. It isn't. Because the operative part of the new law they miss is that every Indian citizen now has a legal right to get domicile in J&K, which did not exist before. The number of years, which is 15 right now, can always be challenged and changed. But it cannot be missed that J&K is now open for all. The change in time limit, another important part that people miss, the change in time limit can be done away with a simple executive order in the future if any government is convinced that 15 years is too long and an impediment. It no longer takes a constitutional amendment to bring about a change in Jammu Kashmir. That is the most important reform that we need to know, that it no longer needs a constitutional amendment. No, it's just such a simple but most important point, and that is often missed by a few. By quite a few, actually, that now with executive orders, you can bring about such changes. And to, just to give you a little gist of what happened after August 5th on the ground. The first real challenge was maintaining peace and ensuring those who benefited from status quo were effectively prevented from causing law and order issues because they were most affected. Prime Minister Narendra Modi owed it to the people of Jammu and Kashmir to maintain peace on the streets and prevent any quote-unquote intifada on the ground engineered by those who don't hesitate to destroy lives of poor people while their own children are in the safe havens of Turkey, Europe, and United States. On this account, the government, Modi government, delivered very well. The streets in the valley remained peaceful, and the only turbulence was seen in the opinion pieces of international newspapers. Srinagar remained cautiously optimistic, and sparks flew in the US Congress at the behest of Pakistani lobby. A reality check was needed for a lot of power centers in the Kashmir Valley, and actions taken after abrogation of Article 370 provided that. no one, not one person, poured on the streets in support of quote unquote popular leaders who were put under house arrest. And no one to this day wants their power reinstated. People of Jammu and Kashmir were complaining about information clampdown, and rightly so. But not one credible voice of support from the masses came for Abdullahs or Muftis. Their family members spoke out for them, and that's all. That's pretty much it. Paper tigers had been exposed. Hurriyat too was unable to drum up support amongst the faithful. The message that finally went out was that this government means business. Post abrogation of Article 370, I must tell you that no incident of mass public.
I think, can someone give her the link? SPRO ji, kya last point kya tha?
About Valley mein abrogation something.
Any, she said there was no unrest.
Okay.
In the streets of Kashmir,
yes. Okay.
In Senate and Congress, because of Pakistani lobbies.
Okay.
That's what she said, and in international op-eds. Yeah,
okay.
That was the last point you made, so you can take off from there.
Okay, I will. I think I lost you when I was talking about the local leadership of Kashmir and what happened to them. So let me quickly go over that.
No, I think you said the Modi government's responsibility was to keep the streets safe.
Yes.
Which they did to a great extent. And then you said most of the unrest was in op-eds generated outside and in hearings by the Pakistani lobby. Utna tak I remember. Then I also got cut off.
She also was talking about some feminism related ladies.
Right.
They were not saying anything about it.
Yeah.
Issues.
Okay. So I was saying that post abrogation of Article 370, no incident of mass public violence has been reported in the valley there, and you can go check it. I mean, there's public information. There has been no loss of life by police action, and there is no restriction on journalists. At the last count, 37 English dailies, 53 Urdu dailies, and 2 Kashmiri dailies are published in Kashmir. Satellite channels and cable television is fully operational. The lack of violence, and this is an important point that I was making, and I think I got cut off. The lack of violence has shocked and disappointed many people who benefit from the conflict tourism in Kashmir. They are not willing to concede, but sometimes facts are less complicated than they are made out to be. Ordinary people in the valley are tired of bloodshed and betrayal by their leaders, whether they are separatists or mainstream politicians. People now want peace, stability, and progress, and they're willing to give life and liberty a chance. When I speak to people, in which I often do, people in the valley, they are open to now new, because they were under so much fear psychosis, and they know that Indian government is no imperial government that is out to crush them. And no apocalypse has happened after, no Kayamat has happened after 370. They are willing to give Indian government a chance. And now Indian government has also spoken in one language and told them that, you know, they are not willing to help in propagating this oligarchy that existed in Kashmir. Many infrastructure projects that were long pending thanks to the apathy of the consecutive state governments have now been started. And this is what has made people very happy, that they've been completed at a record speed. The Rambagh flyover in Srinagar has been open to traffic, and work on very important Jammu-Akhnoor road has been completed. Governing the entire erstwhile state of J&K strictly from the prism of Valley and its concerns is a thing of the past. Equal attention is now paid to infrastructure development in Jammu and Ladakh. The iconic Dal Lake in Srinagar has long battled with pollution that threatens its very existence. It is only now that the J&K government has procured specialized heavy machinery to clean Dal Lake and other water bodies around it. So what has really happened is that Article 370 has opened, think of Jammu and Kashmir as a garden that had been neglected for the last 70 years. And there was a major entrance gate that was stopping anybody from opening it. Now with this abrogation, the gate has been opened. And now you have to get in and start cleaning up and pruning and the whole manicuring of the lawns. So it's not going to be perfect in 1 year, but at least we are making some right steps towards it. Next round of reforms that I feel should address my own people, the question of displaced Kashmiri Hindus. The domicile law brings a sense of ownership in us, in all stakeholders of Jammu and Kashmir, and was necessary, but rehabilitation of Kashmiri Hindus remains a question mark. They've been forced into exile by brutal jihadi terrorism, which engulfed the valley. Valley still struggles with terrorism. So should the Hindus of Kashmir wait till the last gun falls silent? Or should there be a roadmap that can be considered for their dignified return? The problem with waiting for the last gun to fall silent is that guns will never be in short supply as long as global jihadi terror network flourishes. Many roadmaps have been discussed in the past, but nothing has really come out of them. A real roadmap would involve speaking to all stakeholders. The government should now seriously look into the demands of Kashmiri Hindus who have been asking for a separate homeland to be carved within Kashmir. Whether this is possible or not, I'm not saying that, but at least a conversation should happen with Hindus so that they're given a sense of security after the systematic persecution of several centuries. Because remember, this is our seventh exodus. And they are now looking for a permanent solution. They've taken a vow that the seventh should be the last exodus. So many of them are asking for a separate homeland, which may or may not be possible, but at least a conversation needs to happen. The beautiful Kashmir Valley holds in its bosom many tales of treachery and betrayal. Generations have come and gone, but justice has eluded the people of Jammu and Kashmir. Everyone, and I say everyone, has paid a very heavy price for mistakes committed by their leaders. Those who put stones in the hands of young Kashmiri Muslim boys and girls ensured that their own kids got educated in world-class universities in the West. Those who drove out hapless Hindu minorities from their homes of 5,000 years and made them refugees in their own country ensured that they built palatial homes for themselves. This injustice had to end. For how long can people be held ransom for the geography and strategic location of the place they were born in? The abrogation of Article 370 ensures that those who invested in perpetual conflict have no place in deciding the future of Jammu and Kashmir. With that, I will end this. I think I've already gone over time, but I'll be happy. I hope I've answered a few of your questions that you had in the beginning, and I have given a framework of the Q&A session that we will have after this. But all questions, there are no questions are off the table. I'll be happy to take any and every question.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sunanda ji. That was as eloquent, lucid, and illuminating as ever. Thank you very much. And we will, ask for questions. You can send the questions over to chat if you like, because Nandaji can also press the chat button and see the query. Or you can unmute. If I can see you, wonderful, I will call on you. Here's a question from Professor Hitendra Patel. Thank you for a lucid presentation. A major point you've made that Delhi tried to work toward a trust building with the people through the local politician. This has been criticized as the people never had been addressed directly. My query is that has the strategy of working through the politician and using that to the advantage of the party, whichever was there, the biggest error on part of the central government? If so, how different was Atal Bihari Vajpayee's government? And then he adds, give me an honest answer.
Those who know me will vouch for it. I will only speak honestly here. The question, as I understand, is that was speaking via local politicians a mistake, an error? The two family, I won't call it a party, there were no political parties. The two family system that had emerged initially, there was only one family system, National Conference. And we kept working through them. For some reason, New Delhi thought that, you know, they are the only people we can work through in Kashmir. And then once that was gone, in Vajpayee's time, PDP came up and everyone knows what their mandate was and who they were before that, and Mufti Mohammad Saeed's mandate. The idea at that time of creation of PDP was that there should be some competition to National Conference. That was the idea. But then both were family-owned enterprises. Both became, the power was shifted between the two families. And people, the government of India never really got a chance to speak to the people on the ground. So what this was doing, that one way of thinking this is that you must have read in newspapers over the last 20 years, government assigns these many thousand crores to Kashmir. Every, you know, year you would read a headline like that. Where was that money going? The question is, where was that? The money was being assigned, no doubt. It was a price that New Delhi was paying for status quo. But where was that money going? It was not going to ordinary people. Plus, ordinary Kashmiris were not hearing what Delhi was saying. Ordinary Kashmiris were only hearing what the local politicians were saying, and they were telling them that our only job is to save 370, because if 370 goes, then this imperialist Indian government will come and they will probably bring bulldozers and kill everyone. So that was the mindset, that was the fear psychosis that was being built. People were initially terrified. When I say this, it's very difficult for people outside Kashmir to understand. But people in Kashmir really thought, especially the Muslim community there, that 370 is the only thing that is protecting them from evil India, not realizing that India is a constitutional democracy. Everyone has equal rights. So they also have equal rights. In fact, under J&K constitution, they did not have equal rights. They did not have all the rights that government of India and constitution of India gave. So yes, Vajpayee's Kashmir policy, and I have said in the past, was also flawed, but he did not have the numbers that needed to bring in this. I'm assuming that deep inside, he also understood that 370 needs to go, but he did not have the majority, the constitutional majority, the way this was brought. You could not have a discussion on this for 3 years in the country and then abrogate it. That does not happen in India. If you had a discussion for 3 years, trust me, it would have been stalled. So it had to be abrogated like this. For that, you needed numbers, and Vajpayee just did not have the numbers. So by default, his policy was flawed, even though he had best intentions.
Thank you. Now, we've got a couple of more questions, which I'll read out in just a moment. But, you know, I'm reminded of how this government also tried to work through Mehbooba Mufti for quite a while. And I remember, you know, I was in a couple of meetings and where the former CM was there in the Goa conclave and elsewhere. Yes. And I tell you, and even earlier, you know, I was at another function where she was given an award by a very important foundation. I organized that meeting in Delhi. Mm-hmm. And this forked tongue that you spoke of, you know, this kind of double speak, and, you know, it was just, for me, it was stomach turning. And I was thinking, why are we giving these people so much importance when it is so clear, so very clear that, you know, what their true intentions are? You know, they are separatists, you know, what should I say, in a cloak. They've got a cloak of nationalism, but they're separatists. Anyhow, we'll come back to that in a moment.
No, but I just want to add one little point, Makranji. The way it the difference between, there was a very thin line between separatists and mainstream politicians in Kashmir. So what happened was, when you were in government, when you won the election, you were a mainstream government. When you lost the government, you were a separatist. So that's the equation.
Absolutely right. That seesaw, I was saying, I was a witness to that. And then, of course, we saw earlier governments trying to, you know, work with the Hurriyat and all other kinds of leadership as well. And it was almost a no-go from the beginning. And as you said, when we had a chat, isko ek hawa bana ke rakha tha, you know. And you must tell them about the slogan you heard when you were growing up about you know, equating 370 with BT ki izzat and all. You can tell us that incident. And but let me read out the next question. This is from Professor Dataram Purohit ji, and he says some 100,000 Hindus. He says, let me just go back to his question 1 minute, because 100,000 Hindus who were coerced to flee from Kashmir are living in Gadwal, Himalayas today. They are Purohit and Negi, including, I don't know what he means, ninja Negis. I don't know what ninja means. I connect ninjas with those ninja warriors and
warriors, yeah.
Minhas Negi.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Go ahead, Sunanda ji.
So what is the question? What about them? What about their rehabilitation?
Carry on, sir. Aap hi poochiye.
सवाल एक बार बताइए कि आपका सवाल क्या है?
ये ऑब्जर्वेशन था 17th सेंचुरी में औरंगजेब के जमाने में
जी,
तो हम लोगों को वहां से भगाया गया था, उसमें इतने, आज हम 1,00,000 लोग हैं उत्तराखंड में
जी,
और बड़े स्ट्रगल के साथ कहां कहां भटकते हुए अल्टीमेटली हम सेंट्रल हिमालय में पहुंचे थे
जी.
तो an observation when you said there have been 7 ripples of exodus from Kashmir.
Ji.
Yehi tha, baki jyada nahi tha.
So I mean, just to rephrase, I mean, it's a great revelation to me that the Negis and the Purohits of Uttarakhand are actually displaced Kashmiri Pandits.
Yes.
Hundred years ago.
Yes.
In fact, that is amazing. Professor Purohit, can you also comment on the Negis of Gadwal? Because when I, not Gadwal, of Kangra. To Kangra region is full of Negis as well. So I asked somebody there, are they from Uttarakhand? And nobody was able to tell me whether they are from Uttarakhand or from Kashmir or where they are.
They are not Uttarakhand. The Negi, in fact, has been a title in Gadwal. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And Himachal also. Negis means those who collect taxes.
Yeah.
They, people, that is the title. They were the officers collecting taxes. Therefore, everybody acquired the name Negi.
I know. I'm so glad you brought it up, sir, because people don't understand. People think that our persecution began only in 1989-90. Our persecution is as old as the Islamic conquest of Kashmir. So in batches, how does a population, I mean, people talk about genocide and everywhere else, but no one looks at us. How do you ascertain a genocide has happened in the place? You ascertain a genocide has happened when the population of a place goes from 100% Kashmiri Hindus, when we were at one point, 100%, to being 5% in 1989 and to 1% right now.
Yeah.
I mean, if this is not a cultural genocide and a genocide, what is it? In batches, We have been thrown out. Seven exoduses have happened. Seven exoduses that we can count. And Nikis is one of the exoduses that happened in Aurangzeb's time. So seven exoduses that we can count have happened. Why is it that, you know, this is not counted as, I don't like the term, but atrocity literature? Why is this not a part of atrocity literature? Why is this not part of any serious, since this is such a serious academic platform, why is this, these seven exoduses not part of some important academic research, that what happened to this population? And it's sad, just because Kashmiri Hindus are Hindus and they are majority in rest of the Kashmir, rest of India, people forget that we are we became minorities in this state, and there has to be a reason what happened. And today is such a perfect day to talk about this, about what happened to these minorities. It cannot happen. You do not go from 100% to 5% in 1989 to 1% by mollycoddling. That much I can tell you, or by only convergence.
Absolutely. In fact, there are so many aspects to India's past, so many stories that wait to be told and yes. need to be excavated. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, the community that you yourself belong to, you are Saraswat Brahmins.
Yes. Yeah.
And I have done a little bit of work on this, and I found that Saraswat Brahmins from Kashmir are all over India in different parts,
yes.
being displaced from Kashmir at different periods of history. Some are in UP, some have landed up in Goa, some are further south. Yes. So, now we have genomic tracing mm-hmm. as a way to understand. And you're absolutely right. Some work on this needs to be done. But let's take a few more questions. General Shori is with us, and he's asked, Madam, you have touched on the issue of rehabilitation. Do you think the government should plan it now at a macro as well as micro level? Micro meaning rehabilitation at selected safe points in the first stage, especially where security forces are stationed. This is his question.
Yes. Fair, very good question. Now, as I already said in the last part of my thing, that rehabilitation needs to start, because you cannot wait for the last gun to fall silent, because that will never happen. We don't know. And also, a lot of our generation, my grandmother's generation, is now, they're passing away. So we are losing that one generation that had a connect with Kashmir. And then my parents are getting old now. That generation is getting old. How many generations do we lose before we actually start rehabilitation, or before the jihadi guns fall silent? We cannot wait for that. Rehabilitation is based on two things. One is justice. No Kashmiri Hindu will go back unless they have a sense of justice and they know that people who drew them out have been made to face the law of the land. Unless that happens, I can assure you, and I have said this via my op-eds, and I have said this in 2014 when Narendra Modi government came, this was the first thing I said. I said, without sense of justice, you cannot expect anyone to come back. I have to tell you, and this is black humor, not one person is in jail right now or has stood trial for murder of Kashmir Hindus, for exodus, for ethnic cleansing, for raping women, for torturing them. Not one person has stood trial. Yasin Malik, whose name you often hear, it is truly black humor. He is not, and who has killed IFS officers by his own admission, IFS officers, and he killed many more Hindus. He is in jail right now for some hawala transaction. Some money fraud that he did. He is not in jail. He is not been, one of the cases is IFS officer, which finally was opened. But he has been, he's mainly, is the first thing he is accused of is hawala transaction. Another guy, Bitta Karate, who famously used to go around, and there's an interview, and he said it on record in Madhu Trehanji used to do news track interviews those days. And I remember she had him on the camera, and he said that he used to smell, this is his words, Kashmiri Hindus, and he used to go and kill them by the smell. He said, I could smell where they were, and I would go and kill. And he said, I killed 20 of them that I can count. After 20, I lost count. That man is free. No, has been happened. So unless we are told that people who did this to us were brought to some kind of justice, nobody will go back, because then, you know, you always have this feeling that they can come back again because no one was punished. So in a just society, there has to be some form of punishment.
May I come Mr. Makrand, at this stage here?
Yes, please.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you, Mr. Makrand.
And I can see you.
I'm General A.K. Shori. I'm retired.
Yes.
Coincidentally, I was posted as Chief Postmaster in Machal for about 2 years, about 4 years back. The point which you have raised is absolutely valid. What I'm trying to say is that, see that at micro level, there is a need immediately to start a lot of database to be gone through. Now, I assume that the Kashmiri Pandits, Hindus who are settled in Jammu, government has got the database. I assume. If I'm wrong, then this is the time when that, from which place they were brought in. I'm using the word brought in because they were brought in also by that, at that time, by that, by the government, by facilitating their transportation and making all the arrangements. So, particular district, particular place, particular tehsil from where they have come, how much land, holding, business establishment they were having. Now the question is that the rehabilitation to be started when? It can't be started within a day. It will take a year, two, three, four, five. Nobody knows. But the process has to be started. Point number one. Point number two is that, as you have mentioned, that the those specific individuals who are in the jails for various reasons, now the it will also take time. You can't say that till you do those things, only then I will go back. That should also happen, and the process of rehabilitation at detailed at the minutest level should also be happened. Point number three, the time has come when the government should set up a separate special cell for the rehabilitation, where that the state government and the central government must be involved, and the all the deputy commissioners and the tehsildar should be given a specific task within a time on schedule to bring about all the information and then talk to the people. There might be a sizable number of people who will be willing to go to the safer places also. There are so many safer places. Because I served in Northern Command, there are so many command, apart from the command headquarter, corps, division, battalion, brigade headquarter, there are so many places there which can be called safe places also. What I'm trying to say in nutshell is that everything will have to be done now so that the rehabilitation process is started in a phased manner with a time-bound schedule of 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, whatever may be. Thank you very much.
No, I totally agree with you, and I do understand that it's not one after another. It is all these things should happen simultaneously. I concede that. Totally, I agree. As I already said in the beginning, we don't have much time. Generations are passing away, and we do not have time. We do need to go back. So I concede on that point. It's a very well made point, and I take it. The other question also is, sir, that Kashmiri Hindus till now have been kept totally out of the equation. This also we have to understand. Till now, all the conversations that were happening in with Kashmir, it was assumed that they would happen only with separatists and the mainstream politicians. If you remember, all these Indian government was talking to separatists. Indian government was talking to Hurriyat, but they were not talking to Kashmiri Hindus. The our rehabilitation will have to be brought about with our consent. So we will have to be brought to the table. We will have to be told that, listen, we have started this tribunal now, so people can come and they can testify and they can tell their stories. We will record it for the posterity. We will tell people that why were you thrown out? Because till now, sir, we are still called migrants in the official parlance. We are not even called internally displaced, something we've been fighting for the longest time. Refugees, you know, baat hi chhod dijiye. We are not even called internally displaced because, you know, the Indian government doesn't want to do that. They are calling us migrants. Even in this latest domicile law that came, we were referred to as migrants. We are not migrants, sir. We were thrown out of that place. So there has to be some sense of why we were thrown out. There has not been, I have said that a white paper should be brought about and there should be a SIT, a special investigation team should be sent. And this has been one single focus of my writing on Kashmir, on Kashmiri Hindus, that please bring an SIT. Please go through everything that went on in 1989, 1990 and tell the people of country why we were thrown out, what happened to us. Right now, people will tell you that Jagmohan threw us out. He told us in the era where there were no phones and no WhatsApps and not even regular land phones, he organized the entire four lakh community, and he, you know, organized for their exodus, which is all. I was there and I know it's not true. My family did not leave till August 1990 because we were still hoping something would get better. So it was not like the exodus happened on one day and was organized. Yes, a lot of it happened after 19th January, but there were families like mine that stayed back till August. And then finally, our family members were put on hit list, and one of my uncles was shot dead. And we had to, and after that, it became untenable for us. We couldn't stay. But till now, if you ask the government of India an official record on why we were thrown out, none of them. There's not been one paper. There has not been one document. Without that, it's going to be, the trust deficit is not going to be there. But
so,
once
so
this
thank
conversation
you. I think,
happens,
yeah. No, no. I think many dimensions of this process of the return and rehabilitation of the pundits has come up just now. And I think very importantly, micro, macro, the white paper, the acknowledgement of this surreptitious pushing out and genocide, as you put it, as well as another matter, which is that once you throw the valley particularly open to settlement from other parts of India, that will also bring about a demographic shift, perhaps, which may make the safety equations and the other considerations that we were talking about a little different. But here are more questions. That's why I didn't want to. There are many really interesting questions, and we may not even be able to take all of them. But here's a question. I'm just going in the order. Professor Rajveer Sharma ji. Madam, what are the implications of dividing the state into two UTs? What is the future of separate identitarianism and mainstream politics in JNK and Ladakh? And he has another question down below, which I remember. Two of the top state leaders who have been released, Dr. Farooq Abdullah and his son Omar Abdullah, have said that there should be an investigation into why Kashmiri Pandits fled from the valley. And Umar has said that he will only contest assembly elections when the statehood is restored. None has stated that he is interested in street protests and getting Kashmiris killed. What is your comment on these two statements?
Okay.
Oh, this the last one. Sorry, the second one was from Professor M.P. Singh, I think. Yes. Go ahead, please. Okay.
So there was this one question, what are the implications of dividing the state into two UTs? This was, I'm glad that Ladakh has truly got independence. I mean, Ladakhis should celebrate their independence on 5th August. They should celebrate on 15th August as well. But they should truly celebrate their independence on 5th August. They were completely out of the mainstream because they had no voice whatsoever. And they had been asking for it for a long time, that they want a voice in political mainstream. Because of the entire focus on Valley and what was going on in these four districts, there was no attention paid to the state, the, you know, the rough terrain. Ladakh is a very rough terrain, so it needs a lot more attention. So none of that was being paid. So I am so glad now that Ladakhis finally are responsible for their own fate. They have a voice. They can push the reforms that they want. They don't have to wait for the valley-based politicians for anything. Ladakh also has a lot of Buddhist heritage which needs to be preserved, and the valley-based politicians had just absolutely no interest in the preservation or propagation of Buddhist culture. So it is very important that Ladakhis themselves are responsible for this, and they, you know, with the help of union government, they take care of their culture, and they take care of their you know, their books and their scriptures, and which is a very important part. Zaruri darohar hai hamare liye wo. So I'm delighted this has happened. Also, the two union states, that the other union territory now, Jammu Kashmir, this has also given hope for Jammu that now that it's not a state, it is that they will also have some voice, because until now there was no hope of a chief minister, for example, a Dogra chief minister. It was unheard of. You could not even think of that. And you would wonder why, but you could not even think of a Dogra chief minister in Jammu and Kashmir. And so now the needle has moved, and they feel, Jammu also feels, that they're not as alienated. They do have some voice. And for a while, I think the Indian government is on record that they will, you know, statehood will be restored. But I don't see it, and this is just in my personal capacity, I don't see it happening anytime soon. It will take a while, because as I said, it's a, you know, a lot of pruning and cleanup of the garden needs to be done. That will take a while. Once that is done, then maybe some restoration of statehood has to be done. But in the meantime, I do not support that there should be no political, you know, activity in Kashmir. There should be, and it should be encouraged, but it will take a while for the new political voices to be propped up, to come up the right way, not to be propped up, but to come up the right way. And so that will take a while. And so the other question was,
I think you've answered both. Okay. I mean, because you've said that, the implication is that if statehood is not restored immediately,
yeah,
I think the Abdullahs will be benched for a few years, and that is the implication. But here's a couple more questions, so we'll have to, I think we'll stop it here. We'll wind up with these questions. So one is from Dr. Abhishek Yadav, and he says the special restrictions on J&K are also applied to other parts of India in the northeast, like Arunachal, where he's teaching just now. There are interline permits, there are other property restrictions. Even in Himachal, if you're an outsider, you can own an apartment, but you can't own agricultural land. So he's saying that, do you mean to say that the government of India will impose the same, he uses the word impose, the same rules on all parts of India? And then he has a follow-up question, which he himself can ask, about the representation of Ladakhis. But if you answer this one, then Abhishek ji, ye iska jawab milne ke paschat aap khud apna mic unmute karke wo aapka follow-up question pooch sakte hain. Aur iske baad sirf ek aakhri sawal hoga. Professor C.K. Raju ka has been waiting very patiently. And for all you know, we may get locked out, but then we'll certainly take Professor Raju's question and then we'll end up. So you can respond to this, and then Abhishek ji, please follow up.
So a domicile law has already been brought up. I do understand that Himachal has some, all hill states typically, you know, have some domicile laws. So a domicile law has already been brought up for the same reason, to protect the people of J&K, or give them some rights as residents. The only difference now is that it's not 370, because other outsiders can acquire domicility after they show that they have some interest in residing in the state. As of now, it is 15 years, But it's going, I have a feeling that it could change in the future. But right now, if you've stayed in 15 years, or if you have worked in, I think, central government officers who have already worked in Kashmir for a certain number of time, or students who have who are not Kashmiri domiciles, but have written their 10th grade exam and 12th grade exam in Kashmir, they automatically become domiciled. So these laws have already been brought. It's not a thoroughfare. It's not a, that anyone can go. So those laws have already been brought in, like there is in Himachal or in other places. What has been done away with is this insularity, that you cannot even interfere in anything. You cannot do anything about the laws that were being made. Your laws were not applicable anywhere in every nook and corner of the state. So that has been done away with. But as far as this is concerned, yes. I do anticipate this domicile law to stay, and it has already come about.
Abhishek ji, follow up सवाल जल्दी कीजिए please.
हाँ बस 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 एक मिनट की बात है सर. मैं ये इसमें जो domicile नियम है इनके बारे में बता दूं कि बस दो बातें कि जम्मू कश्मीर में जो नियम थे उससे ज्यादा कड़े नियम है नॉर्थ ईस्ट के राज्यों में, और ये वहाँ वहाँ कोई जमीन नहीं ले सकता, न कोई खरीद सकता है, चाहे आप 50 साल रहें 40 साल रहें, कोई जमीन नहीं ले सकता वहां पे. मेरा सिर्फ ये कहना था कि जिस तरह से इसको ऐसे फोकस कर दिया गया कि सिर्फ कश्मीर ऐसा राज्य है, जम्मू कश्मीर, जहां इस तरह से वो भारत के दूसरे नागरिकों के लिए भेदकारी है, ऐसा नहीं है, ऐसा दूसरे कई राज्यों में है. इतना इसको सेंटिमेंटल इशू बना के पूरे देश में इसका प्रचार किया गया. और दूसरी बात मुझे ये कहनी थी कि अरुणाचल प्रदेश और लद्दाख दोनों ही चीन से सटे हुए हैं, और दोनों ही जो मैकमोहन लाइन है उसके उनसे चूंकि सटा हुआ इलाका है, इसलिए वहाँ कंट्रोवर्सी होती रहती है. चीन दावा करता रहता है, अभी हाल में इतना चीन ने इतनी बदमाशी की है लद्दाख वाले हिस्से में. मेरा ये कहना है कि अरुणाचल में चीन का दावा कमजोर करने के लिए उसको राज्य बनाया गया. इंदिरा गांधी ने उसको उनके समय में उसको नाम दिया गया अरुणाचल प्रदेश. राजीव गांधी ने उसको स्टेटहुड दिया. मिजोरम में भी ऐसा किया गया. मिजोरम में आज आलम यह है कि जो जिन लोगों ने हथियार उठा के भारत सरकार के खिलाफ लड़ाई की, आजकल वो विधायक हैं, अब वो खुद भारत सरकार को डिफेंड कर रहे हैं. मैं हैरान होता हूं इस बात से कि एक राज्य को बना दिया गया केंद्र शासित प्रदेश, और उसमें लद्दाख में एक लेफ्टिनेंट गवर्नर बैठ के शासन करेगा. मुझे नहीं समझ में आता कि ये कोई बुद्धिमत्तापूर्ण डिसीजन है जिससे कि हम लद्दाख के लोगों को ज्यादा रिप्रेजेंटेशन दे पाएंगे, या ज्यादा वहाँ हम अस्थायित्व, वहाँ स्टेबिलिटी ज्यादा डेवलप कर पाएंगे. मुझे नहीं लगता कि ये कोई उपाय है कि इन दोनों को जो है इनका स्टेटहुड छीन लिया जाए इस स्टेट का. आखिरी बात बस जोड़ देता हूँ, निदा नवाज हिंदी के, मैं हिंदी का आदमी हूँ, हिंदी के एक बहुत फेमस कवि हैं निदा नवाज, उनको साहित्य अकादमी युवा पुरस्कार भी मिला है. उनसे जो बात होती है उससे पता चलता है कि घाटी में जो शांति जिसको कहा जा रहा है ना, वो बहुत एक कड़ा शब्द यूज कर रहा हूँ मैं, मुर्दा घर की शांति है, निदा नवाजी कहते हैं ऐसा. बस मेरा यही बात थी मेरी.
जी आपने कहा कि इसको एक केंद्र शासित, ऐसा तो कभी हुआ ही नहीं है भारत में कि आपने किसी स्टेट को उसका स्टेटहुड छीन के उसको एक यूनियन टेरिटरी बनाया है, ऐसा कभी हुआ नहीं है. मैं आपको बताऊं कि ये करना बहुत जरूरी था अभिषेक जी, क्योंकि वहां पे कोई वजह ही नहीं थी, कोई तरीका नहीं था फॉर द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया टू ब्रिंग अबाउट इट्स प्रोग्रेसिव लेजिस्लेशन. वहां एक दीवार बना दी गई थी जो अरुणाचल में नहीं, मिजोरम में नहीं, जहां पे मैं मानती हूं कि वहां पर भी बहुत सारे कठिनाइयां आई हैं, कोई आम इलाके वो भी नहीं है गवर्नेंस के, पर यहाँ पे जो एक अनफिनिश्ड एजेंडा ऑफ पार्टीशन माना जाता है कश्मीर को, जहाँ पे पाकिस्तान की कंटिन्यूअस एक वो रहती है, आज भी वो गए हुए हैं एलओसी और कश्मीर हाईवे को श्रीनगर हाईवे बना दिया और ये सब कर दिया. इतना ज्यादा इंटरफेरेंस जिसको वहां पे पाकिस्तान की वजह से था, इट वॉज वेरी इम्परेटिव कि इंडियन गवर्नमेंट वहां पे एक तो लोगों को बता दे कि देखिए अब आपका स्टेटस एक क्वेश्चनेबल स्टेटस नहीं है, क्योंकि वो 1947 में डिसाइड हो चुका था. अब आप यहाँ के साथ हमारे साथ मिलके इकट्ठे चलिए तो हम शांति की तरफ चलेंगे, हम प्रोग्रेस की तरफ चलेंगे, हम ये बीच वाला हिस्सा नहीं रखेंगे जहां पे टेबल की तीन ही टांगे हैं और एक टांग से गिरते जा रहे हैं, हम लोग कभी खड़े ही नहीं कर पा रहे हैं मेज को। तो ये करना बहुत जरूरी था। कश्मीर में कोई सिर्फ इन दो घरों, इन दो फैमिलीज के अलावा अभिषेक जी कोई डेवलपमेंट जमीन पे थी ही नहीं। बहुत जरूरी था लोगों को इंडिया का बेनेवलेंट फेस देखना, एक इंडिया का जो अगर आप मानते हैं कि इंडियन स्टेट का एक बेनेवलेंट फेस है उनके सिटीजन्स की तरफ, तो वो शक्ल, वो सूरत कभी कश्मीर घाटी के लोगों ने देखी ही नहीं थी। मैं आपको बता रही हूँ, उनको ये लग रहा था 370 हटेगा तो मोदी जी पूरे बुलडोजर लेके सबको वहां पे खत्म करने आएंगे। उनको लग नहीं रहा था कि मोदी जी भी कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के में फंसे हुए, ऐसा कोई नहीं कर सकता, कोई नहीं कर सकता। तो चाहे किसी के पास 303 सीटें हो या चाहे किसी के पास फ्री की पूरी सीटें हो, ऐसा नहीं हो सकता। इंडिया इज कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल रिपब्लिक, ऐसे नहीं हो सकता। पर वो एक बेनेवलेंट फेस घाटी के लोगों को दिखाने के लिए ये बहुत जरूरी था। मुर्दागर की शांति जो आप बता रहे हैं ये भी एक डर है जो बनाया हुआ है। मेरी जब लोगों से बात होती है वो ज्यादा डरते हैं टेररिस्ट से, उनकी वायलेंस से बताने में डरते हैं, क्योंकि उन्हीं की वायलेंस हुई है, उन्हीं के लोगों ने अजय पंडिता को मारा अनंतनाग में अभी, उन्हीं के लोगों ने वसीम, तो मैं कह रही थी वहां पे टेररिज्म है, एक्टिव टेररिज्म है, इसकी वजह से ये मुर्दा शांति आपको टेररिज्म की वजह से सुनाई दे रही है, इंडियन स्टेट की वजह से नहीं सुनाई दे रही है। और ये इसलिए नहीं कि मैं कोई इंडियन स्टेट की वहां पे आप कोई वकालत कर रही हूँ, पर मैं रही हूँ वहां पे, मुझे पता है कि गन पहले किसने लाया, और वो गन जब आ जाता है कहीं पे अभिषेक जी, फिर उसको निकालना बड़ा मुश्किल हो जाता है, बहुत मुश्किल हो जाता है। और पिछले 30 साल हो गए हैं ये गन निकल नहीं रहा, ये वायलेंस कंटिन्यूअसली है वहां पे। कल भी वहां पे एक राइफल मैन है इंडियन आर्मी के जो अबडक्ट हुए हैं, उसी की वजह से कर्फ्यू लगाया गया, फिर हटाया भी गया था, फिर हटाया भी गया। तो ये एक वजह है मुर्दाघर की शांति की। अदरवाइज लोग डरते हैं उन लोगों से जो बिना किसी के, जो हर किसी को वहां पे मौत के घाट उतारते हैं सिर्फ ये कह के कि आप इंडियन गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से बोल रहे हैं या मुखबिर हैं या आपने आप पॉलिटिकल या किसी एक्टिविटी में आ गए हैं, अगर आप सेपरेटिस्ट नहीं है उनको पैसे नहीं दे रहे। तो कश्मीर में बहुत बहुत जो आपको दिखता है वहां पे वो कभी नहीं होता है, जो आपको नहीं दिखता है उसको टटोलना पड़ता है बहुत ज्यादा। तो ये एक मैं आपको कहूंगी कि बहुत अच्छा कहते हैं जो आपके दोस्त हैं, लेकिन उनको ये भी सोचना पड़ेगा कि वो कहाँ से आ रही है मुर्दा शांति।
Absolutely. I'll just add a footnote. Actually, there's a market for this kind of literature and these sorts of voices. I once, many years ago, you know, trained a student, and then I found that he was superimposing Palestine on the valley, and then unko, you know, bahar se bhi protsahan milta hai. One of my other friends, you know, he traveled all over the world, and you know, in New York and elsewhere, he says, "I'm not an Indian citizen. I don't believe in Indian citizenship." And then somebody asked him, "Which passport did you travel on?" You know. So what I'm trying to say is that there is a marketing of dissent as well, and it certainly suits some people, just as there may be a marketing on the other side which may suit others. So we'll leave it at that. Last question to Professor C.K. Raju.
Thank you. I hope I can be heard.
Yes, sir. We can hear you. Yes.
Okay,
yes, I can hear you.
So usually it's the first question, this time happens to be the last. Now I am asking because you said no questions are off the table.
Yes.
We've been hearing all these other things for quite some time. My point is about your, well, what should I call it, giving too much bhav to Ronald Reagan. Now the question is that there was a genocide in America. We are talking from the time of Aurangzeb. There was a huge genocide. No, it started with 10 million. You're talking about a lakh of people here. But 10 million and they were all butchered. And not only they were butchered, that butchery was celebrated. And Ronald Reagan was one of those who made those Western films and celebrated. So it's a very jarring note if you start with Ronald Reagan and talk of genocide. Please don't do that.
I was only quoting what he said, and Ronald Reagan may have his limitations, but he was also a very wise man. In the sense, I consider Reagan.
He started the Star Wars program, which almost led to a world war.
Yes, you know. In politics, there are a lot of things that happen, and most people are responsible for a lot of things. And as analysts, we should look at all sides, and we do, as you rightly did. And it's also possible to probably take a quote from them here and there to make a point. The other day, I quoted people who know my ideology and people who know what I stand for. And yet I took a quote from Lenin to make a point that sometimes, because what was happening, I said sometimes nothing happens in decades and sometimes weeks happen in decades. This was a quote made by Lenin. I don't agree with anything that Lenin says, but this was a quote that I like very much, and I like to put it in current scenario. And this was the only reason why I used Reagan. There are some aspects of his leadership that I appreciate, and there are many that I don't. And this is true for all leaders. People who make a change in the world are not always controversy-free, and that is why they make a change, because if they didn't have any controversies attached to them, they would be sitting like me making breakfast for my family.
thank you, very well put. In fact,
when you speak about genocide, and when you're talking about one kind of genocide or exodus, you're living in a land where there was a huge genocide, where there was not just an exodus, everybody was finished off. And you can't put both of them, I mean, you have to accept
the point taken, this land is no promised land.
And talk about the other, right? That's, I think that is very transparent to you. But please do keep that, no? Otherwise it sounds very insensitive.
Yeah, absolutely. I just want to say, Professor Raju, that the complicity in the wiping out of the native populations of North America as well as of South America, you know, it's so huge, and it can't be placed, you know, upon only one leader like Ronald Reagan, just because he made Westerns. And there are so many revisionary Westerns where, you know, you're shown the same people in a different light, right from Searchers, Uske Piche Stagecoach Tha, where the Indians just come like forces of nature and shoot arrows. But, you know, the paradox of the United States, you know, one of these countries which is considered, you know, imperialistic, this, that, and all, is also that it has indeed thrown open its doors to several immigrants. So it's a very complicated question. But I just want to say one thing. When Sunandaji was talking about quoting Reagan, Ronald Reagan, I was just going to say most probably his lines were written by somebody else, because Reagan's great talent is great. You see, I was in the US during the Reagan years. In fact, I saw how Jimmy Carter, a perfectly decent and, you know, a Democrat who loved India, Lillian Carter was so interested in India, how he lost because the US doesn't like wimps as leaders, and they found that the hostages were in Iran and Jimmy Carter couldn't do anything about it. And let's not forget that Ronald Reagan, whatever else he did, he brought down the Soviet Union. I mean, along with Margaret Thatcher and John Paul and so forth. And he was shot by John Hinckley Jr. I was in the US at that time. So I lived through the so-called Reagan years and the complete tilt of America towards the Republicans and the conservatives. And I think things are really complex. And I can only say that the U.S. is a much, much more deeply divided society today than it was in the 80s, much more.